So Irma asks if you guys saw the D4 live stream. Did you guys already talk about that?
Kinda, not on stream, but
so no, Worm hasn't heard about it much. Egg actually did tell me a little bit about it.
Yeah.
I forgot until just now.
Yes, so I watched it. I also watched it.
Yeah.
And then
I did not watch it, but I read the recap.
I think that's fine. I think a lot of the words they said were fine, maybe even good, but them not saying certain words was bad, and there was notably some stuff that was not good.
It's just some unacceptable reasoning.
When you say words, do you mean phrasing or do you mean topics?
Like responses to
topics.
And also just the way that they went about talking about things, I think, was okay.
I don't think
so. I think some was...
The first half was them... The first half of it, the first things they responded to, they very clearly, without saying it to your face, said that they know better than you, we're the developers. And they're going to do what their vision is. And that's the same thing I've heard from PUE as it gets... fucking ran down the drain. So like and it's because the choices that they're going to make and continue making are just fundamentally bad. People don't like those things. So it's like, also just skip to the end saying that it being confirmed now that most of that's anything they talked about isn't going to make it in as early as to somewhere in season 2 is cringe and absolutely unacceptable. We all realize that that's like next year, right?
Yes.
Huh?
Yeah.
No, I know.
It is fucking next year, dude.
Well, no, it's probably the end of this year.
It'll probably be like November or December.
Yeah.
But they then said it's going to be sometime during season 2, not even at the start. So like,
I mean, I would imagine it's there at the start of season 2.
I don't think so. I think they're going to like push certain of those. I don't think they want them. I don't think in their design, I don't think they want Nightmare Dungeons to have portals.
I guess, but like they said that they were gonna do it. We'll see if
when has Blizzard ever not done something that they said they're gonna do? Come on, Egg.
Yeah.
Get real.
That's such a good track record of completing their.
Uh huh.
Oh yeah. By the way, guys, Overwatch PvE. Yeah, it's just not ready for launch. It'll be there. Oh,
when?
It's been 6 months? Yeah, we canceled that like a year ago. My bad.
Huh. Weird. Strange.
You said
it was coming.
No, I never...
Huh.
We'll take your money, though. Here's another Battle Pass.
Oh, Battle Pass.
I think
FOMO.
That...
FOMO.
FOMO.
Battle Pass. Battle Pass.
I think that their response to Nightmare Sigils being... that they're going to give us a teleport is good. Even though it might take them some time to get that implemented. I think that them responding to the incentive of Nightmare Dungeons only being to increase XP is at
least
something.
It's unacceptable. It's not even something. It's just unacceptable.
I mean, it is something.
Yeah, but it results in nothing because it doesn't increase the incentive.
I'm sorry, what was the topic? What was that? What was that last point we were arguing about?
The Nightmare Sigils? Or there's
no.
Two points on Nightmare Sigils.
Not the portal. I heard that part.
The second part was the XP.
They're upgrading.
So increase the XP gains of Nightmare Sigils as you go up in difficulty.
Didn't they just nerf those? Like, can't they
No, they've nerfed the amount of monsters.
Which does nerf XP.
And they're not going to change... Yes, correct. But they're not going to change the amount of monsters. They're going to change the amount of XP that monsters give.
Yeah, but that's not the problem players are having. That's not the concern at all.
But my density.
Yeah, dungeons are literally
a lack of understanding of the problem.
So I think that's a really interesting point. There was a thread where someone had some like ludicrous density and they were like, hey Blizzard, this is what the game should be. And what was super interesting was that thread was like 50-50 divided, where people were like, that's really arcadey and like D3 and I don't want that, and the other people were like, that's fucking awesome.
Yeah,
I do think that there are players that want the, I think Sato is one of these players, that wants the playstyle of you engage D2. A couple mobs at a time and
D2 you engage a lot of mobs at once.
You engage a couple mobs at a time and it's like a battle in order to kill
them. You want an MMO.
But what Sato wants is PvP.
What Sato wants in a dungeon experience is an MMO.
He also just wants the experience that PvP provides, where like your combat is tense and
very tactical.
Yeah. You're not sure who's going to win at the outset.
Okay.
And that's just not, that's not what PvE ARPGs
the flare
should be.
So I do think that genres or games that are in a genre do not have to strictly adhere to every attribute of that genre, but I think that it's much more difficult to change the attributes that are either the most common or that people perceive as the biggest pillars of the genre. And I think ARPG combat would fall into one of those.
Yeah.
To me, the talk showed that they have no fundamental understanding of the weaknesses of their game, or they accept, or somewhat they accept them, but they did them intentionally. And they think it's a benefit.
They're like, hey guys, look, PoE's doing this.
I think their answer to the resistance, like defenses in general, was really bad. It wasn't worded well, and it was just not good. Essentially, when they responded to defenses, they essentially said, oh, our players don't know what they're talking about when it comes to defenses. Perhaps you just didn't notice that there's this penalty applied to resistances. And it's like, no, we know all of this stuff.
It's just bad.
Stupid. We know how the numbers work. Like,
we've done more math than you guys.
Obviously.
I don't know about that, but like,
no, it's very obvious that
tone of it was not good on the response to defenses, where they needed in this update, in the fireside chat, they needed to have more of these are the problems, here's how we're fixing them, or like not talking down to the
players. They just doubled down. They did the same
thing. I think part of the talking down, the strategy in my mind is one of, if we say that, oh, the players just don't understand, there will be a subset that doesn't understand and is like, oh, all these people complaining, they just didn't know what Blizzard knows, or like, oh, those people that are having problems, they didn't have the knowledge on how to combat this thing. No, it's fundamentally not working. And like, that's what needed to be said, was that there's fundamentally defenses are not structured well, and that did not get stated, and that's unfortunate.
It's very obvious when they're balancing defenses, they either ignored or purposely just decided that a certain tier was not going to be viable.
But only for
classes that rely on one type of resistance.
Yeah, it's the intelligence classes that get absolutely destroyed by these defensive
because it basically means that that intelligence-based classes have no defense. It's basically what it results in when you crunch the numbers at the end game, is we have no defenses. And it's like, that's not acceptable. And then they're just like, no, you just don't understand. That's not a response. That's just, you're being insulting. Like,
you guys don't have phones?
Also, they had a response to resource generate, like there was a question from the audience about resource generation. I didn't like their response to that question either, about like They don't want it to be trivial to regenerate resource all the time. And like,
I take a, so it definitely seems like they have a vision of a game that they want to make, and they're just kind of hoping ARPG fans will like it. Yeah. And
like, actually looks,
I
fucking
think
cool,
their vision,
this,
also
this fighter
PoE. Yeah, I thought so too.
This fighter looks sick, man.
I thought so too.
I also think that what they see that vision as being present all the time, and ARPG players want to feel more powerful. And so then they say, look, this doesn't fit our vision. And people sort of listen to that and say, okay, but I've been getting gear and levels of Paragon and glyphs and gems and whatever aspects. And so if that's going to be how it is at the start, my progression should move me past that because I should feel more powerful. The point of me building to something in some direction should allow me to not worry about whatever the things are in that direction that I'm building, because that's normally how an ARPG works, and that's normally the strategicness of making those decisions about how your character will operate that go into an ARPG, and that's why people play it. And for some reason, that just doesn't seem to be what they want the gameplay to be, and they decided that that gameplay makes most sense in an ARPG.
Yep.
I don't know, watching, like, I've been watching a lot of, I was watching a lot of the Throne of Liberty content, looking at a little bit of Weathering Waves early testing that got pushed back, and then, like, Blue Protocol. Like, it's very, like, it, they want to balance the game like an MMO.
Yeah, it definitely seems like they had some sort of design philosophy or gameplay philosophy that they wanted to push, and just got the funding for an ARPG instead, and just decided that that was the best catalyst for it.
This is the skin we're using for our, for the game we wanted to make.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, I think some of their attitude, when I, like, see them present it the way they are, to me almost seems like they think they're pitching a Dark Souls-like game.
Yeah. That too. It seems more like they wanted to make a Dark Souls MMO than they wanted to make a Diablo ARPG.
Few mobs, intimate tactical content, a real look at life and resource generation. Items don't come that quickly, or change in abilities are not super in depth, and your playstyle doesn't change much past your base very early configuration.
Yeah, I don't. It, the Fireside Chat told me some things. I don't like the, like, the result is a slight improvement, but it does not show. It's a slight improvement eventually, is what it is. But it does not show me that the developers are actually going to make a game that I'm going to enjoy, or that I think that most ARPG players are going to enjoy. At least soon. We might get there eventually, but like, it does not look like we're going to be seeing those changes in S1 or 2.
I don't expect that we're gonna get any of the changes that we really care about until the expansion. And I don't think that we'll get all the changes we want. I can understand, with the amount of overwhelming criticism about the systems in the game, that if you are going to, on some systems, holistically change them, and on others, do massive quality of life, stability, and cleanup on, that it's easiest to pay for that development within the context of an expansion. Were there other points in the chat you guys wanted to discuss?
They mentioned that gems will become a material, which hopefully they follow through on that this time.
Yeah, that was already
supposed
to be
the second
thing,
time so they, like, promised that. Yeah.
It's the third time they promised it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
They mentioned that materials wouldn't have a cap, which is good, a good improvement, but definitely should have been in the game at launch.
It's just a no-brainer.
Material conversion also to not have up the cap.
There, so, like, one of the things that they did not talk about, which I think is bad, deafening in the silence, is they didn't talk about respec costs and how that is unacceptable.
They also confirmed you're going to have to do all Renown again.
Yes, they also talked about Renown, and well, they were like, oh, I mean, don't worry, guys. They started out talking about Renown by saying, man, it feels really bad right now when you get on a new character and you have to go click the Lilith statues again, and you have to go do your Fog of War and go do your waypoints again. And so in Season 1, because essentially Season 1 will just be we all make alt characters, we're going to make it to where you don't have to do those tasks. Except I think I would have to go back and listen to it again. I think we are going to have to click on waypoints that aren't the capital city again. But like waypoints that we'll get our capital city waypoints and we'll get our Fog of War revealed and we won't have to click the statues again. And then they kind of moved on to another point, but then they came back to the Renown thing and they hammered it home that, yeah, you're going to have to go get your blue quests and your dungeons to fill up your Renown.
You will have to do 12 dungeons and about 30 blue quests per zone.
Yeah.
Which is unacceptable.
Yes.
Also, having to get your waypoints again is unacceptable.
I think that they want... I kind of expected the dungeon thing, because I think they want people to fill out their codex again, so I don't think they just want, like...
Uh-oh.
I mean, I think ideally they want players to do all of it again, but...
They realize players won't.
I think that they don't want someone to get four rares and slap the build together that early. I think they want there to be, like, the several hours to just get your character going.
Medium?
Yeah.
Several hours of your character not playing well because it's not designed?
Well, I think that they feel like they have to because they made the codex the way it is, whereas, like, in D3 or PoE, you still have to get the items, or at least in PoE's case, someone has to, and then you can trade for it. And so there's a little bit of, like, just that unforeseeable progression, and since they made fixed progression... or acquisition, rather, in D4.
Just be better at the game, guys.
But yeah, because they have fixed affix acquisition, I think that they feel like they need to do that.
I hear you feel a lot of things. I think they're wrong.
Yeah, I agree.
How many times have I told you not to talk with your mouth full, Egg?
Didn't they say something about, like, 13 pages of patch notes coming soon?
I don't recall.
Yeah, a large client patch is planned covering 13 pages of patch notes, including fixes and additional performance
issues.
I really
thought Percy was going to get that.
I thought I got that too.
Yeah. Huh? That's a sword.
They did spend a lot of the first bit of it talking about how, like, just like the minutia of how they deploy fixes, which I thought was not...
Worm.
Yeah. Well, Cruz's power
is increasing. Use the golden energy. I don't know, not super relevant to,
anything.
Yeah. I get that it's hard for you and game dev is hard, but like that's not what you need to tell us here in this live chat.
Also, what they're telling us game dev is what they were telling us game dev is hard for isn't like relevant at all. It's a what people are actually concerned about. Because relatively, their patch deployment had been good.
Fairly good, yeah.
Because they haven't done any patches.
Okay, good. But I think what they were... The purpose of that was to say that, hey, we have to, you know, make updates across multiple platforms at once, and like... We have to make deployments across multiple platforms, and so like... It seemed to be like that was the reason why we might not be seeing as many updates as we might want, or
any updates.
I mean, they've been doing updates. They're just going in the wrong direction. Like the problem we have is not the cadence of the updates; it's the direction of the updates.
Well, the updates are also only involving nerfing, like specifically dungeons. Like they haven't really done any other hotfixes other than the dungeon thing and disabling and re-enabling barb stuff. They haven't actually done any balance to other classes other than that first pre-patch.
There are two kinds of patches, though, and players, I think, largely think that there's only one kind. Going in and changing the numbers on stuff is like where they do balance changes is very easy, or depending on the systems they have, changing the density. Again, I hope that they have more, as much control as we're hoping. But when it comes to like adding new features or reworking whole systems, you have to do a lot of quality assurance, and it takes a lot more time to deploy that kind of an update. Like, bug fixes are much more isolated, so they're easier to deploy.
That's what I was trying to say. But they didn't believe me.
Right. But I my point is that I'm not concerned with the cadence of the updates. I'm concerned with the direction of the updates.
I'm concerned with both, but especially for a brand new game. Where are you at? You're over there. Down there.
Snack. What exactly do you mean by the cadence?
For cadence of updates, I mean that they seem to have people actively working on things and making changes, which is a lot more than can be said for, say, Diablo 3, where you have the Natalia's bug in the game for like multiple days, where it's, or like the God VH bug was in for multiple weeks, and it's like, there's just clearly no one actually looking at shit in D3, for instance. And so, like, it feels like there are people doing that for D4. And so, they actually do go in and make changes. I just don't like the changes that they make.
I also think that they're just not doing that fast enough for the size of game that they released.
I mean, perhaps I am anti-spoiled from Diablo 3, but...
I mean, back in the day on D3, they used to change stuff quicker than they're doing for D4. D4 is a different scale of game, but that's why they should have a different scale of development. It's a different era.
I think there's also probably a difference in quality philosophy between D4 and D3. In D3, it was clearly just one guy doing stuff every few months, and I don't think Blizzard really thinks that game.
That's post season 5, though. Like, post season 7 is where it really shifted. But yeah.
Yeah, but the point that I was going to make is I think that guy was probably like whatever works, and then just pushes it in a way that's not just egregiously bad. Like it's. I imagine that when it was down to one engineer on D3, it was probably, as long as it's not a bad implementation, rather than let's shoot for a good implementation, because they're never going to get a second engineer to come back to look at that game, so why does it matter? Whereas on D4, I think it's the opposite. And so some updates, it's like, depending on how the system is built, you might not be able to have more than one guy work on it at a time, but that conversely means that because you have such a large team, that you can, if there are multiple systems that have to be changed, you can have them all start to be made at the same time. But again, I think that they're looking for quality changes, which means reviewing and making sure that it fits the design pattern in a way that they can continue to add to the game easily. Because it sounds like they want the game to have a pretty healthy lifespan.
True. That was one of the points that they kept trying to hit on, was that they want the game to be good for a long time.
Yeah, but it's not going to. It's not good now, so it can't be good for a long time.
Well, it can be. You can get good later and be good for a long time.
But yep. if what they consider now is good, it's doomed.
Well, regardless of what they think, like, the pace of updates is always going to be slow.
Yeah. Which is not good. Or how many problems the game started with.
You're correct, that is not good, but that's just the reality of the situation. Like, it's always, even if the game was stellar and people said, can we get these improvements, it would still be slow.
Yeah, which is why I'm saying it's doomed that they made the game so bad at release. Because it's like, well, now we really know we're not getting these things fixed. Fuck, I can't hit this guy. Stand still, you fucker.
Don't worry, I'll kill him.
It's probably easier to patch D3 since it was separated from the crossplay settings. Yeah, but like the main reason why patching on a console is bad or so difficult is because you have to screen it through the company that owns the console. Like a Battle.net patch, Blizzard can just be like, okay, it's good, push it. But like they have to tell Microsoft about it, and then Microsoft has to deploy it and approve the patch.
Yeah. I heard Sony was actually really bad about that, and that hurt a lot of games.
When it comes to console development, Sony is one of the worst. Like, if you want like an Xbox dev kit, like my roommate, he's working on like a, imagine like Valorant but in VR, and you can like cast spells with like hand motions. The game is called X8. If you're curious, and that sounds kind of cool, I'm just gonna plug that. But cool.
Well,
yeah, they're gonna have like a tournament. It's a free to enter game if you have a headset. They're in-game transactions only. Anyway, so there's a, like a, my point is that he's got an Xbox dev kit and a PlayStation dev kit behind us. And the PlayStation one is like, it costs money to get it, like $3,000 for the dev console. It requires two different Ethernet cables because it requires two different internet connections. You have to register the exact location you're using it at with Sony. And Microsoft is like, you want to dev kit? We'll just apply, my friend, and we'll ship it right to you. And then that's it. That's, you get it and you can work on it. Do you guys have any opinion of their point that a vast majority of the D4 players have not completed the campaign?
I bet that's true.
I think I can disagree with the point.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not asking if you agree or disagree. I'm just saying, do you have any thoughts on it?
I mean, I think that that's not unexpected. And I think that I don't disagree with their data. I think, though, that the majority of people watching the stream had completed the campaign, just because that's the nature of your power
people
users.
Watch streams.
Like, there's a huge gulf between the average user of Diablo and the top end of Diablo, like the people that know life the game and or are like informed about things.
It's also only been out for 2 weeks and it's a 100-hour campaign.
Yeah, well, it's 100 hours of like, it, and they're still working on it, so.
Pain. Actual physical cringe.
I don't know. The, I think it is important for Blizzard to consider those players that are still doing the campaign. It is important to have feedback from them and have thoughts towards them, because they are the majority of players. However,
Baldur card! Fuck yeah!
I think that a lot of...
You're getting there, Egg?
I am, dude.
However, I think that a lot of the issues that the more hardcore players have, if those were to be remedied, they wouldn't come at the expense of the people who are still doing the campaign.
They're only a benefit to them. So, most of them are a benefit to them.
I don't think that they would feel it. I don't think that they would care if, like, you're able to have the toughness to do a Nightmare 70. Like, they're probably never going to enter a Nightmare 70.
Okay, but adjusting, resistances helps them at all points in the game.
Yeah.
Because at most points in the game, you are underleveled.
That was another thing that I think they didn't bring up that I think was deafening in their not addressing. So respec costs they didn't address, which I think is really bad. And they didn't address the prevalence of enemies crowd controlling you.
Ah, yeah.
They also didn't address the dynamic scaling.
Right.
I think that seems to be a very big point. I know a lot of people, I think, like, even the people who do get to level 70 or 80, I think there's some merit to this point that a lot of people think by that point, you're basically, like, depending on how far you want to take the character, that might be as strong as your character ever gets, because you're not getting new skills, you're not getting points in skills. Your Paragon board's gonna start to have diminishing returns at that point. You have all the aspects you want, you're really just changing stat ranges on items. But you still have 20 more levels to go, and when you level, the enemies just get more difficult.
Yep.
So at about 70 or 80 for most people, that play longer than like the typical casual, maybe the like 20%. That's the most powerful their character's going to be, except that the game only gets harder from there.
Yep.
And there aren't these great rewarding moments, like when you feel like you can comfortably do a new torment in D3, for example.
Yeah, I don't know. I think that the format was maybe not the best. I think that they... I guess it's better than nothing. It's better than them not communicating, and so... Like...
Oh, you mean for the whole chat?
Just like the format of the like fireside campfire chat.
Yeah, you're,
where
yeah. I wasn't sure if you were talking about that or the scaling.
Oh yeah, no, for the chat.
Right.
Because it didn't feel like they got a chance to address everything because it was a bit meandering and I don't know. It felt like they tried to be on task, but it's hard to be on task when you're four people talking.
And I think that there's a bunch of systems in the game, and they all have a lot of levers that to talk about any system does require a lot of effort. I didn't really watch the pad or the chat. I just got the cliff notes on Wowhead, so I don't know like how their demeanor was, but I do understand that there's only so much that you can talk about in a manner that you should talk about it with any given amount of time.
And, yeah, I don't know. If they continue to do them in the future, I think that's a good thing that we're getting communication, but I think I would prefer there to be someone that is more representative of the community, able to at least give the appearance that they're being beholden to the community, as opposed to able to go where they want.
Yeah, I kind of think that they should just do another round of those, like, streams or interviews with various people, and just let them ask the questions. I really, really enjoyed when Quinn had asked Wyatt Cheng if there were game session drop tables in D3, and Wyatt Cheng just decided to debate what the definition of is.
I think that's why we're not getting these. It's because they have a lot more control when they just have in-house people.
Well, I mean, we got them before, but now post-launch, given the vocal attitude, I don't think that we will, but I think we should.
Also, they didn't say anything about mount dismount taking 20 seconds to get back on it.
Ooh, that's another thing they missed. They didn't say anything about the roadblocks going away.
I'm hoping that if they're going to have, I'm air finger quoting, but you can't see it, 13 pages. Oh. Of bug fixes and stability changes, that loading from zone to zone will hopefully be much more seamless, which will at least be some net positive to the mounts.
What are you guys talking about? Mounting, unmounting, taking 20 seconds?
In Diablo.
attacked when you whip out the dog.
Yeah, but what about it?
When you get dismounted by a mob, so your horse has health, the amount of health it can take. If a monster hits you and it dismounts you while you're on your mount and you don't get off it like with your ability, it puts the horse on a 20-second cooldown.
It's 30 seconds actually by default, but your CDR can lower it to 20 seconds.
Yeah.
Wow.
If you just simply dismount because you hit the wrong button,
it's like a 6-second cooldown. Well, it's like 6 of my cooldown, but yeah. Yeah.
Huh.
One, those things shouldn't scale with CDR because they shouldn't need to because they should just be lower or non-existent.
They should not exist.
They shouldn't exist. Also, like, you can dash unmounted in town. You can't dash on your house or on your horse.
On your house?
Yeah.
I dashed on my house.
Oh, God.
Also, where's my player housing?
That man's riding a house.
Where's my player housing?
Yeah, that's another thing they didn't address was the city layouts being really bad.
Just one town that's not shit, please. Like, just give me one town.